So this second half of our symposium looks at mainly at developing skills and moving into the implementation of shared decision making. So I'm sure you'll all be thinking, well, it's all very well to have tools to help patients and clinicians, but tools are of no use if people don't find them useful, for starters, if they're not relevant and they're not implemented, and if people don't know how to use the tools, then they won't be used or they'll be used in the wrong way. So we think this is a very important aspect and something that I think internationally is really gaining momentum, this recognition that we have to include skills development in our clinicians and also in our patients and our consumers in order to really put this into practice. Otherwise the tools will just sit on the shelf. So as I mentioned in my introduction, we're very lucky that Glyn Elwyn from the Foundation for Informed Medical Decisions in the US has pre-recorded a talk. It's a series of questions and answers that Heather actually sent over to him. And I'll just let him speak for himself. I think you'll find his thoughts quite engaging. I'm going to let that just run, and then I'll introduce the second video speaker.
Hello, my name is Glyn Elwyn. I'm talking to you from Dartmouth College. Sorry that I can't be with you. There's a research group here which I'm leading, and I'm delighted to speak to you about the MAGIC program, which I think you want to hear a bit more about.
Glyn, would you be able to briefly describe the MAGIC program funded by the Health Foundation?
Sure. It was an implementation program. We did work in Newcastle University, and I was based in Cardiff University at the time, and it was really the Health Foundation wanting to understand what it would take to try and implement shared decision making into the National Health Service. We did that in many ways, or tried many things at least, and I can speak better about the Cardiff experience, so that's what I'm going to do. We worked with about four specialty teams in the hospital, and we worked also with a number of general practices. Some of the specialty teams were breast cancer. We also did work with the ear, nose and throat team on two areas actually, throat cancer or head and neck cancer, and also tonsillitis. I tried to do that. So let me just concentrate on those two teams. We tried a number of approaches actually. What we kept hearing from the teams is that they were kind of already doing shared decision making. And we weren't quite convinced about that, but we wanted to explore that. So we ran a couple of workshops with them to say, here's what we think is shared decision making. We ran lunchtime workshops because it was very difficult to get clinicians to come together for workshops. And those were introductory workshops for the whole team. We're trying to get them together. I mean, even that was actually quite difficult. Once we got that into place, we ran more extensive workshops for about 2 or 3 hours where we would say, here's the concept, here are the skills, and here's how you would implement it into practice. And we found it really difficult to get clinicians to come to those. Conflicts in terms of scheduling and so on were the main barriers. Anyway, the result of running those workshops was that we immediately found that the clinicians didn't have the same understanding as to what shared decision making was. They thought they knew what we meant by that, but when we explained it in more depth, they quickly realized, well, that's not really what we do. And that they realized that there was much more to it. As we explained more about, there are multiple options that can be considered, and there's much more information that you can give to patients about the harms and benefits of those options. And here's a few things about how you might do that. And then they quickly realized that they weren't doing that, not really. And that was the beginning of a completely different conversation with the clinicians. And there are many other things that I can tell you, but I think let's move on with the questions that you've given me.
Sure. Have any of these projects undertaken as part of this program continued beyond the project funding and become part of mainstream clinical practice, or led to routine use of shared decision-making in specific clinical settings?
That's a very good question. The project that we ran in Cardiff and Newcastle were for about 2 years. And it's fair to say that there were real challenges for us in trying to implement shared decision making. Here's the challenges that we found, and I'll tell you whether or not they were continued on for a number of years. The first challenge I've already said, that clinicians told us at first, we're doing this already. They were very confident. And then they realized, well, maybe we're not doing it to the same depth as you're talking about. And then we said, well, here's what would help you. What would really help you? And they said, well, the information that you're telling us to tell patients about harms and benefits, we don't really have that at our fingertips. And we certainly don't have it in a way that we can explain it easily to patients. So we said, okay, well, maybe we can produce something short for you to share with patients. And I said, sure, we'll give that a go. And the idea here of making one page available to clinicians came up, and we called these, for lack of a better word, grids with options on them. And here's where the idea of option grids started, as it were. And they liked this idea. They liked the idea of something that they would develop themselves with us and lead to them being able to have these kinds of conversations with patients. Ear, nose and throat did this for tonsillectomy. We did one for breast cancer. And that seemed to go down very well. There was a lot of debate about the content, but because they had come up with the idea and they generated the content, they were willing to use them, at least to some extent. The other major idea was to try and measure something, try and measure whether the patients were making good quality decisions or not. And that was a challenge. And we followed the word of Karen Sapuka here and said, well, how about we give the patients some knowledge questions and also whether or not their decisions were aligned with their informed preferences. Well, the knowledge questions, first of all, were really difficult to come up with. And there was pushback. The clinician said, we can't ask questions to patients about knowledge. That would be too hard for them. And actually, we almost stopped at that point because it was really, there was so much resistance in the clinical team that we almost stopped pushing for that to happen. But eventually, we asked one of the clinical nurse leaders, and it was very interesting, I think, the nurses that were most prepared to do this, say, why don't you give these questions a go for one or two patients? And she did. And she found it very interesting that the patients were very happy to answer these questions. There was no resistance on the patient level. And she found that the patients didn't know the answers to very simple questions about breast cancer, the questions that there was information in the option grid about. So they began to say, well, that's interesting. We thought we were doing a much better job than we are about telling them about these issues, but clearly they don't get it. So let's start asking more patients these knowledge questions. They did it before, or sorry, they did it immediately after their first conversation, but also they kind of found the answers to where the knowledge deficit was and did, again, tailor their home visit to try and help them improve their knowledge scores. So the nurses found this useful in real time. They were saying, well, you've got the answer to that wrong, and you've got the answer to this right. But when we see you next time, we'll make sure that you get all these questions right. So the knowledge questions became a very important tool for the nurses as they saw the patients after they were given the diagnosis of breast cancer. So they began to use these questions routinely. And it's very interesting now, 4 years later, they're still using these knowledge questions and they're still using the option grids. And this is, if you like, something I hadn't really expected, because we had a real difficulty in implementing these kind of ideas in other teams. The tonsillectomy team are not using the option grids and they're not using knowledge scores. We weren't successful there, and I can tell you more about why we weren't successful there.
In the places that you were successful, what are some of the elements that you think were important in helping getting adoption of these tools beyond the research setting?
that there was a real philosophy in the team that informing patients was important, and that most members of the team understood and agreed with that philosophy. We actually had in the breast cancer team 4 or 5 consultants, specialists, and a very good nursing team. They didn't cooperate very much together. They all saw patients in their own kind of clinics, but they had a unifying philosophy, actually, that they were prepared to inform patients and to do that. In fact, they had higher mastectomy rates than some units in the UK. And they found that they wanted to almost reassure their managers and other clinicians that this was because they were informing patients. But they'd never had data about this before. So the nurses found the knowledge course useful on a practical level, and the consultant found the aggregated data from the knowledge course as justification. Well, here you have, here's what patients are choosing when they're well informed. And so they found that very important. A barrier to this was the other team, the head and neck cancer team. We did all these workshops with them. What we found was that we thought this team had the same philosophy about sharing decisions with patients. And what we actually uncovered was that many of the consultants didn't agree with this at all. Some of them even went so far as to say, it's our job to tell patients what to do in these complex cancers. Why would you ask for their opinion or their preferences? And so we actually created a big debate in this team. And I think some of them even fell out with each other, and we caused tension. And because of that tension, there was no agreement to use these short tools to inform patients, and there was no agreement to use knowledge questions by the nurses or by the doctors. And so we weren't able to move forward, not because there was a lack of skills in my view, but because the attitudes were at variance with one another. And actually wrote about this. The paper called Patchy Coherence talks about the theory by Carl May about normalization process model, now theory, talking about whether people have the same view about the work they do. And it was very clear in this team that they didn't have the same view about the work they do. They weren't of the same mind about informing patients and involving them in decisions. So that led to an implementation failure. So if I was to sum up, what makes a difference? Having the clinicians lead the way and the nurses working together on a unified view about the importance of this approach. And some data which is found to be valuable by people on the ground seeing patients, but also at the aggregate level to inform how well they're doing. And so those are the two critical success factors. What was really difficult for us, I think, and I want to just kind of touch on this, it led to more ideas, is that these knowledge questions are really difficult to prepare. They have to be specific to the condition, and you have to get agreement about what the knowledge issues are, the gist of the knowledge, and that's very difficult to get agreement on. So we were always looking in the MAGIC project for, is there a generic measure of involving patients, which is short and fast and so on? And we didn't manage to get to one, but when I came to Dartmouth here, I think I was kind of determined to try and crack that issue, and I think as a consequence of the magic word, it led to a team here forming the collaborate measure, which are 3 small items, or short items, which actually we try and do this, but we're still testing with that particular tool at the moment.
Can you describe the actual process you used in developing an option grid? How do you decide the topics? Which key user groups do you get involved? When do you do that? How do you do it? Can you give us an overview of that?
Sure. Well, I have to admit that it's been a bit reactive so far. We've reacted to the demand of clinicians and said, could you make us an option grid for this issue? And they have been usually in the kind of common areas where there are really clear, reasonable options to compare. And that, I think, is the key issue. is there a set of two, maybe three, not much more because it gets too complicated, I think, of clear, reasonable options that most clinicians think it's very reasonable to put these in front of patients. So that's the criteria for where we develop them. How we do it? Well, I think if we had all the resources in the world, we would do empirical research on what are the frequently asked questions that matter to patients. And we would interview patients and do focus groups and so on and try and get those. We haven't got all the resources in the world, so we try usually and say, has there been anybody else who's looked at the frequently asked questions? Or, failing that, we ask experienced clinicians, what are the questions that you think patients really worry about or concern about? And often, of course, they have a very good idea, but often they have also blind spots to what worries patients. So it's not ideal, but I'm with Voltaire here, that perfection is the enemy of the good. So we're really happy with something rather than nothing in terms of the philosophy of the option grids. And then we go to the evidence and we try and shortcut again to go to systematic reviews or Cochrane reviews, and if we don't have those, we'll go with our expert opinion. So it's a very practical approach to developing these short tools. But we try as much as we can to get a version one and publish it, and then take comments. And if there's any problems, we'll issue version two, version three. So in other words, it's an iterative process. We think that guidelines are okay, but they don't get us very far. We think that putting evidence in the hands of clinicians and patients together on the table that they can share is the way to go.
Thus far, how have these option grids been used in practice? So what kinds of interventions have been required to promote adoption into routine care?
Yeah, I wish I knew, really, is the answer. We've had quite a lot of downloads, I think, to date, about 50,000 downloads. We do have a trial going in the UK of a knee osteoarthritis option grid, and we're analyzing the results of that trial at the moment. We've got a couple also of implementation studies going on here in the US, one on a circumcision option grid, pre-post design, looking at videos of clinicians using it after a tiny bit of training. We've got a researcher here from the Netherlands, Annemijn Arts, is going to do it on heavy menstrual bleeding, and she's got some work to do here to collect residents using the grids there. What we're finding, I think, is that these tools lead to more engaging conversations. They lead to patients asking more questions. But we're also learning that the use of these tools doesn't come naturally to clinicians. They don't get it. If you just give them the grid and say, please use this with the next patient, they don't get it. They need a little bit of guidance as to, you know, explain the layout, say that there are options coming down, frequently asked questions coming this way. And you need to guide the patient to say, read across, understand that there's comparisons going on, and then use a pen or something to mark it up and ask me questions. And we're also finding that patients, when faced even with one page of information, get overwhelmed. We're thinking that it may take some time for them to read them quietly for 5 or 10 minutes and maybe step out of the room so that the clinician can see another patient who's already seen a grid, so that you develop a cycle of people who are reading this information and then coming back in, so that they've had time to digest this information. Even though it's brief, it's new information. And also, we're finding that clinicians don't know the data in these grids. They don't know the numbers, they know the gist of it, but they're not familiar with the numbers that we're putting on them. So that's also helpful for them, actually, to have an idea of these numbers. So early days in terms of evaluating their use, but we're getting demand for making new grids that we can't keep up with. So that tells me something, that somebody's finding them useful.
You touched on this a little bit before, but in your estimation, do you think there are feasible ways of measuring the use and effects of decision aids in general in routine practice? And do you have examples of any health system or healthcare provider that's actually doing this?
This is really difficult. The holy grail would be to measure an informed choice and informed preference, and as I've explained, that's really difficult to do because you need condition or decision-specific knowledge questions, and then some idea of how to evaluate the preference and whether people have got it or not, whether they're aligned, and that's really difficult, and there's still a big research area to try and do that. What we've tried to do to circumvent that real burden of data collection and generating consensus around knowledge, what we've tried to do is to create a shortcut or a screening tool to say, is there an effort made by the clinician to inform the patient about any health issues? Is there an effort made by the clinician to be curious about the patient's preferences at all? You know, are they asking what's important to you? And then is there an effort made to integrate or to respect those preferences as decisions are made? And I've just paraphrased the items which make up collaborate with this short patient-reported measure, which we think that, because it's generic, because it's short, you can use in any situation after any clinical encounter. And we're trying to see whether this kind of generic tool gives us a screening for whether the clinician is trying in any way or shape or form to inform and to do shared decision making. Now, whether they're doing it well and whether the patients are really getting to a better knowledge, that it doesn't answer that issue. But I think what we've got so far is some indication that's giving us a signal at least to whether somebody's making some effort to engage the patients or zero effort, and that we're getting some evidence that this tool is picking that up, and that's a start. In primary care, it's almost impossible to have a set of knowledge questions for all the hundreds of decisions, but for a specialty area, you might well develop a knowledge score for breast cancer diagnosis, for example, which is still going in Cardiff. They're still using that, for instance. But it's a labor of love, I'm afraid, to get to knowledge scores that are consistent and there's consensus around them.
Well, keeping that in mind, do you think that patient decision aid should be an integral part of clinical practice guideline development?
I'd go further. I think we should stop making clinical guidelines, and we should make short tools for clinicians and patients to use together. The guidelines can form the basis for that kind of tool, but we should stop really producing so many guidelines for clinicians who are never using them. They're sitting on shelves. I think we should invest in these short tools that create better conversations.
Just to wrap up, I was wondering if you could share with us any lessons from either the UK or the US experience with shared decision making and the development of patient decision aids that you think would be useful for other countries who've not invested as heavily in these approaches to date.
Sure. Well, I think what we've learned so far is that people have kind of equated the dissemination of decision aids with shared decision making, hoping, I think, that if we produce good tools for patients, that will lead to better conversations, to more shared decision making. We have very little evidence that that's the case, very little. And there's been a conflation of those two issues. I think we're beginning to realize that we should measure the process in the encounter, audio tapes of people trying to use decision aids, short tools, what happens to patients when they've used longer tools outside or before. We should really measure the process. And there's only been a few centers that have tried to do that. We did that in Cardiff a decade ago. People in Mayo Clinic are doing that, using videotapes of the clinical encounters. But very few other people have actually looked at the process. In terms of moving forward, I think it's more about the attitudes of the clinicians to have better conversation based on some evidence. And for that to happen, we need transparency, tools that are used by clinicians as much as they are used by patients. And I think that's where the next research frontier is.
Well, thank you, Glyn. Is there anything else you'd like to share?
No, I hope you have a great time in these workshops in Australia. I'm really sorry that Richard Thompson wasn't able to be with you, but I'm delighted to have been able to make this video for you.